Jesus is better. Did you know that? That Jesus is in the business of doing miracles, of touching lives, of loving us, of helping us, forgiving sin, removing shame from our lives. And I just love to hear about what Jesus is doing. And I believe that this is a very important time for the series that we're going to, because I believe that a lot of times we need to refocus on just the central thing. And really the central thing of all of the Bible, and the central thing, really what should be the central thing of our lives, the central person of our lives, should be Jesus Christ. Does anybody say amen to that? he can do absolutely anything. And it's so amazing to me that it's not our needs that disqualify us from being able to come to God. It's not our issues. It's not our sin. It's whether we'll come to Him or not. That's really what's going to separate whether you walk in freedom, whether you receive salvation, is not so much what you've done. What bad things have you done? You know, what good things have you done apart from God? How good or how evil are you? Do your good deeds outweigh your bad deeds? It's not so much what you've done. It's where are you going to go with what you've done? And that's really the message of Hebrews, is that God wants us to have confidence, especially in these first five chapters, have confidence that we can approach Him boldly, and that He's a high priest who has compassion upon us. So God does not wait for your mess to get cleaned up, right? Like our friend Leif said the other week when he was here, in God, you don't need to take a shower before you can go get clean, right? You get to show up just how you are. And God's the one who cleanses you. So I heard a testimony when I was in Atlanta. This speaker, David Wagner, his son Benjamin, told him at one point in later elementary school, he said, "Dad, I want to quit going to private school. I want to go to public school. I want to be a light in the darkness. It's not that fun to be a light where all the light is. And I feel like I'm supposed to reach other kids that don't know Jesus." And so as he's going through the public school system, I don't know if he's in like middle school or high school, he sits in class one day. God speaks to him about his teacher and says, "You need to give your teacher a word from me." And he's like, "This teacher's like kind of perverse, and this teacher's really cruel and doesn't let anybody talk to him." And the teacher's even said in this classroom, "You cannot approach my desk ever. It is inappropriate for you to come up without asking." And so he's like, "God, you know my teacher, he doesn't let us go to his desk. He doesn't let us talk to him when it's study time." So he said, "Well, God, please, if you want me to really share this with him, please have him do something." So the teacher, like a minute later, says, "Hey, if any of the students in the class have a question about anything, you just come up to my desk and you can ask me." So he walks up to this man, doesn't trust God, not a good dude. And he says, "I have a question for you, but it's not my question. It's a question that I have for you. Can you go into the hallway with me so I could ask it to you?" And he walks out into the hallway with his teacher. And he said, "I felt like I heard God say this in my heart. What happened 2 years ago that gave you a broken heart and left holes in your soul?" And a tear goes down his teacher's face. And he says, "2 years ago, my wife died." He said, "Well, I believe that God's saying that if you'll, that he has something for you that'll totally change you. If I could introduce you to somebody that could take away the brokenness of your heart and fill all the holes in your soul, and he could totally heal your pain, would you be open to having him in your life?" And he's like, "Absolutely." And he tells him about Jesus. And he said, "I believe God's telling me that if you open your heart to him, God will take away the perverseness. He'll change you, and he'll make you a man after God's own heart. That's what I feel like the word I'm supposed to give you." He begins to weep and surrenders his life to Jesus. And he pulls out of his wallet a piece of paper. His mom had died, I think it was 20 years ago. I might be wrong on the years, but many years before this, his mom had died. And he had carried around in his wallet what she had written out as her last dying wish. She said, "My last dying wish is that before the end of your life," to this teacher, her son, "that you would be called a man after God's own heart." Surrenders his life to Jesus. He's a literature teacher. He starts teaching the Psalms and Proverbs as literature in his room. And this speaker, his son, Benjamin, co-authors a sonnet with the teacher about like the beauty of God or something like that. See, here he is in the middle of darkness, and yet God pursues him to redeem him. That's the picture that we see of God in Hebrews. This is the picture we see of God in Jesus is better, as Jesus being our compassionate high priest. And, you know, there's not chapters and verses. If you didn't know this, like if you have a Bible, you could turn it open to Hebrews 5. And if you don't, we could give you one tonight at the end of service. You can also download a free one on an iPad or a tablet or a smartphone or something like that. But Hebrews 5, I read from New King James. There's like all these chapters and verses here, right? But in the original scriptures, there's no chapters and verses. It's just like an index system so that we can say, instead of like, hey, that one part where he's talking about the high priest, and you got to try to, you know, get there and figure it out. We could just say, hey, chapter 5, verse 1, and everybody could just turn right there, right? So this is really a continued thought from Hebrews chapter 4. And we had just learned in Hebrews chapter 4 last week that Jesus is a compassionate high priest. He's a compassionate high priest who sympathizes with us in our weaknesses. He's tempted in all points that we are, yet without sin. Therefore, it says we can come boldly to the throne of grace to find mercy and grace to help us in our time of need. Who receives, anybody go to the throne room this week to try to get some mercy and grace besides me? Come on, I'm there every single day. God help the boy. I need help. I need mercy. I need grace. I'm telling you what, right? And so we can have so much confidence before God. And I also want to honor my wife tonight because before I pray, I'm going to pray and we're going to read the Bible, getting the rest of the message. It's our 12th year anniversary. You want to stand up, sweetie? Because some people may not know. That's my wife, Grace, and November 6th, 2004, we tied the knot, exchanged vows, and we have four beautiful kids as a result, and it's been an amazing 12 years, and I'm really thankful for her in my life. She's so amazing, and, oh, thanks, babe, and it's, yeah, I know, I get distracted, I get kind of pulled into her tractor beam, and I'm like, oh, I gotta focus, but it's fun to be able to celebrate marriage and to honor my wife on this day. So we're gonna pray about Hebrews 5. Jesus is better. I'm going to talk about the priest and the process, and we'll read it, and we'll dive right in. So, Father God, I thank you for your love. I thank you for Jesus being our high priest, that you're compassionate, that you're eternal, that Jesus, you were a man of godly fear. You came in the flesh, and you, through your obedience, you learned obedience through the things that you suffered, and you became a qualified high priest to represent us before God, that we could have confidence in the salvation and the righteousness that you freely give. And, Father, I pray for revelation today in our hearts. I pray for open hearts. I pray that you would move by your power. I pray you'd remove false beliefs and that you would touch lives with hope and courage in this place in Jesus' mighty name. God's people said, amen. So Hebrews 5, verse 1 reads that for every high priest taken from among men is appointed for men in things pertaining to God, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can have compassion on those who are ignorant and going astray, since he himself also is subject to weakness. Because of this, he is required, as for the people, so also for himself, to offer sacrifices for sins. And no man takes this honor to himself, but he who is called by God, just as Aaron was. So also, Christ did not glorify himself to become high priest, but it was he who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he also says in another place, "You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek." Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with vehement cries and tears to him, who was able to save him from death and was heard because of his godly fear. Though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Called by God as high priest according to the order of Melchizedek, of whom we have much to say and hard to explain since you have become dull of hearing. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Amen. All right, so here we go. We're going to look at priest and process. So continuing this thought from Hebrews 4 that Jesus is our high priest, we learned that Jesus became like us. And I used to think that the most important thing for us to realize, or the first step to really realizing our salvation or our freedom in God, is realizing that Christ has invited us to become like him. to share in his inheritance. But as I've been studying the first five chapters of Hebrews, I realized that's really not the first step. In fact, there's something that's pretty marvelous here that we see in Hebrews chapter 5, is the first step to understanding our salvation is not that we could become like Jesus, but that he perfectly became like us. That we don't first have to figure out how we come to God. We have to have an understanding that Jesus became like we are. This is a big, big, big difference. See, like if Jesus is up in heaven, right? Jesus came, opened the door, became a sufficient high priest for us so that we could have a relationship with God, understanding that he perfectly fulfilled everything that was needed for us then to go with him back through the door, which is him, back into heaven, back into the gift of eternal life. So the Christian life does not start when I realize that I can become like Jesus. It starts by realizing that Jesus took on the form of flesh to become like me. And freedom starts to come to us when we realize the perfection and the completeness of what Jesus did in becoming in the likeness of sinful flesh, in being willing to take on the likeness of our infirmities, the likeness of our weaknesses, of our temptations, of our trials. And see, Jesus is this amazing high priest. And I'm excited about this, if you can't tell. Because this takes the pressure off of you and me. And there's a repeated theme in the first five chapters of Hebrews, because there's many hard statements in the book of Hebrews. In fact, I used to be afraid to read Hebrews, because I always felt like when I read Hebrews, it reminded me of why I don't measure up. Earlier in my Christian life, I always thought, oh man, I'm the one that's like insulted the spirit of grace, or must have gone too far in my sin that God couldn't accept me. And I lived in this shame and this guilt every time I read it. But what happened was I was reading the book of Hebrews through my eyes. How am I making it? Have I become enough like Jesus yet? Have I done this? And it's appropriate at times to use the Bible to measure our obedience and to check our motives and to check our hearts. But God does not use the word as a weapon against us, right? He never brings us into shame. And what happens, though, is when we start to look at Hebrews or any scripture through the lens of Jesus, through who Jesus is, confidence starts to arise in us, because we realize it's not about our level of obedience or our level of trying to muster up how to be more like Jesus. It's about, first of all, what he did to become like us. We're going to learn tonight that he perfectly fulfilled everything that was needed on our behalf. So he begins to talk about how Jesus is the sufficient high priest for us. And this is going to bring us hope and courage and confidence before God, I hope, so that we'll run to him and get free from our sin and walk in the purposes that he has for us in our generation. Amen? And so many Christians are under so much shame and hopelessness and continue to look to their own selves and their own limitations and live in a life of despair instead of living a life in confidence in God, knowing that he loves us, knowing that he's paid for us to be fully redeemed, for us to live boldly before him. And I just love this picture that he gives us at closing chapter 4, that it's in our time of need that we come boldly. Now, we think in our time of need, that's when I'm least qualified. But we see again and again and again, in the time of my greatest need is the time where I can have great boldness. If I can have great boldness in my greatest need, then I can come anytime on my worst day to my best day and anything in between. Can I get an amen to that? That's what he does. He invites us to come. And when you listen to a voice that tells you, you can't come to God, God's ashamed of you, God's tired of you, you're gonna do that again, what's wrong with you, right? And you feel like you got to be pushed away from God, you're always listening to the wrong voice. You're always being pulled by the wrong force when you're pulled away from him. See, Jesus wants you to know that he's come to take on sin. He's come to take on the weakness that you've been tried with and you've been tested with, and he loves you. And so the author begins to lay out for us, why is Jesus qualified to be our high priest? And in Hebrews 5, there's five reasons here in this passage that Jesus is qualified to be our great high priest. First of all, it says that he's qualified to be our great high priest because priests were selected among men so that they could have compassion on those that are going astray. Number one, why is Jesus qualified to be our high priest? Because he has compassion. He has compassion. This is good news. Compassion on those who are going astray. Now, if there's anybody that never feels like God's going to have compassion on them, typically in our American culture, it's Christians that are going astray. But it's so fascinating to me that he says that the priests have compassion because they realize that in their own flesh they have limitations and they're likely to go astray. But it's in the place where they go astray that he's moved towards compassion. If you're struggling with going astray in your Christian life and you have a picture of God that he's not compassionate, not trying to move towards you and help you, then you've got to get a new picture. You got to get an upgrade, right? Because this is who Jesus is to us as high priest. He's compassionate. You know, I don't know. I believe sin is not something that God takes lightly. Sin cost God the Father his son. It cost Jesus his own blood. Sin affects our relationships with God and with others, right? Sin is costly. It's damaging. It's horrible to be stuck and trapped in sin. I know from experience. I know from learning in the Word. And I know from seeing the effects that it has on our culture, the corruption, the immorality, the broken promises, the broken homes. Sin is devastating. So it's not that sin is a light issue. It's that in the midst of our sin is that Jesus wants to help us out of it. Right? And it's not that we become light on sin. It's that, that if we take sin seriously, then we'll come to the only source who can truly help us out of it. That he has compassion on us when we stray. He has compassion. He's moved with a feeling of compassion. He knows what it's like. We learned last week that he's tempted in every point that we are without sin. So that means every way that you've ever been tempted to sin, Jesus was tempted the exact same way. The devil has this little thing. The Bible tells there's a real spiritual force called the devil, and you got demonic assistance, right? This is the worldview that the Bible gives us of what's happening. There's one world, but there's two realms, right? In the spiritual realm, there's this kingdom of darkness, and the devil loves nothing more than to try to convince you that what you're going through and the temptations that you have are so much weirder, so much darker, so much more horrible, so much more unacceptable that you'll run in shame and you'll never get the freedom that you need. But the writer of Hebrews, he's going to give us a lot of warnings and even some rebukes and say, hey, you got to check yourself on this. You might need to repent. You need to watch out for this. Don't take this salvation lightly. But it's so interesting that he's packaging all these warnings along with this clear revelation that Jesus loves you and has moved towards compassion with you in the midst of your sin, in the midst of your temptation, in the midst of your weakness. And how you see him and how you see scripture in light of how you see him will affect everything in your life. First of all, why is he qualified? Because he has compassion. He doesn't condemn us in the midst of our needs. Number two, why is he qualified? Because God appointed him. The writer goes on to say, this men did not appoint themselves, and neither did Jesus appoint himself as high priest. As Aaron was called by God, and Aaron was the first high priest of the people of Israel, he's like, we got a better high priest than Aaron. This high priest, it was promised in the Psalms, two places, that you are my son. Today I have begotten you, in verse 5. And in verse 6, you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. Why is Jesus qualified to be our high priest? Because God said, you're my son, Jesus. And you are going to be the high priest according to the order of Melchizedek, a priest without beginning or end. Melchizedek means king of righteousness. And he was also called the priest of Salem, which means priest of peace. See, Melchizedek was considered one without beginning or end. So he's a picture of Jesus being eternal. Melchizedek then being eternal, right? If he's a priest that's eternal, he represents all people for all time. So Jesus is not just a priest of the people of Israel. He's a priest for all people, for all mankind, for all time. And we're going to go more into Melchizedek next week. But the thing is, or in the next few weeks when we get to Hebrews chapter 7, not next week, because we'll be on Hebrews 6. But the thing is that Jesus was appointed. He's called. He's chosen by God to be the right high priest for us. Third, the author goes on to say, this high priest is eternal. Why is he qualified? Because he's eternal. He's qualified because he's, first of all, he's compassionate. Secondly, because he's appointed, he's chosen by God. And thirdly, because he is eternal. Do you realize that Jesus' representation as high priest for us is a ministry that he has performed that is sufficient for all sins of all mankind for all time? Before the cross, since the cross, and for the rest of time until Jesus comes back and makes the kingdoms of this world subject fully to the reign of his kingdom, is that Jesus Christ, come on, Jesus Christ is sufficient as the eternal high priest for all of us. And number four, why is Jesus our great high priest? I'm glad you're asking that question. godly fear. Why was Jesus qualified to be our great high priest? Because of godly fear. Godly fear. It says that he was heard. His cries were heard from the cross when he let out these great vehement cries and prayers. That God heard his cries because of his godly fear. Jesus feared God. Jesus honored his Father. Jesus knew the fear, living under the fear of God is not living under fear that God's going to get you all the time. It's honoring God. It's acknowledging him. It's looking. It's knowing that his eyes are always upon you. And because you're in love with him, you want to do what's pleasing in his sight because you care about your relationship with him. Right? There's some people that would do all sorts of crazy, but if their mom or dad showed up, there's no way they do that same crazy in the room. Not because they're necessarily afraid of them, because you have a healthy fear. Like, that's my mom and dad. That's my grandma. I can't do. Why? Because you haven't got this. That doesn't mean you're always like, oh no, I'm afraid of them, right? But you care about their opinion. You care about what they value because you love them, right? And Jesus had a godly fear for his Father, for who his Father was. And it's amazing to me that Jesus is here pictured as being on the cross as the Son of God, and he's letting out these cries. And it says, because of his godly fear, God hears his cries. And he listens to Jesus' prayers, but he doesn't pull Jesus off the cross, which leads us to number 5. Why is Jesus qualified? Because of obedience. Because sometimes God hears your prayer, God hears your cry, and you found favor in his sight, and he continues to let you go through a time of suffering for the sake of teaching us obedience. So Jesus learned obedience, it says here, by the things that he suffered. So powerful. Jesus learned obedience by the things that he suffered. Could it be then that the only way for us to learn obedience is to suffer? If Jesus had to learn obedience through suffering, could it be that the road to maturity is having to go through suffering? You know, the Bible never promises Christians a trial-free life, suffering-free life, never. When you suffer, Romans 8, you're the sons of God if indeed you suffer together with him. Never, ever promises you suffering free. The only time you get suffering free is when you're fully in the kingdom of God, in heaven, in a new earth, at the end of all time, right? That's where we cease from all of our toil. But in this life, we're never promised. Some people have preached the gospel like, your life's going to be so easy if you give your life to Jesus, and God's just going to bless you, and you're going to get this awesome wife or husband, and you're going to get new cars, and God's just going to bless you, and you're going to live 3 simple steps, and you just give, and you just go to church, and it's like, no, the Bible does not promise you an easy life. It doesn't promise us an easy life. But what happens is that we start to learn that the sufferings and the trials that we go through in this life are not an experiment on whether we're accepted by God or not. I just prayed with somebody this morning who's weeping and saying, well, why is God doing all this if he loves me? And see, and this is exactly what I was preaching about, is that we go through things sometimes because of our own sin, right? The Bible says we shouldn't suffer for our own sin. Don't blame God for something that you did, like, illegal and then got caught for it. And like, why am I going through this? Right? We shouldn't suffer for doing evil, 1 Peter. We should suffer for doing good, for living for Christ, for being a witness. Right? But when we go through these sufferings, it says that Jesus was a son, yet he suffered. He learned obedience through the things he suffered. So his sonship was secure. God's like, this is my boy. This is my son, Jesus. I love him. He's beloved. I'm well pleased with my son. And now, son, you're going to go through some things that are going to bring maturity and perfection. The word perfected, that Jesus was perfected, it means to become complete, right? And see, in the person of Christ, God, who is eternal, entered into time, taking on human flesh to be tried with the experiences that we go through. And then God himself, in the flesh, in the person of Jesus, started to know what it was like to suffer, not by mere knowledge, but now by experience. And that's what's happening to make Jesus an acceptable high priest, is that Jesus suffered through experience. Now, there's some things you can know, right, by reading it in a book, but come on, how many of you can't know that to the level of somebody who's walked through it themselves in real experience? And this is what qualifies Jesus. He's not a God who's just distant somewhere saying, get your act together and try to live a better life, but that he entered time and our space in a body to suffer and to feel what we felt, right? And he... he submitted to this process of perfection, of completeness. And there's something about going through trials that matures your character, right? Romans 5 talks about this. And that character, it produces perseverance. And that perseverance in trials and in suffering, it starts producing character. And then pretty soon you start developing hope after character is developed, right? And eventually hope doesn't disappoint you because you know that the love of God has already been poured in your heart anyway. And so you know that God is for you. So you stop looking at life like, why am I going through this? And you start looking at life saying, God, thank you for bringing trials into my life and suffering into my life so that I can have even more of a realization that I'm already your son and that you love me and that you're trying to do this to complete me and make me mature and whole in my life. See, God's love for you is never on trial by what you're going through. Never, ever, 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 ever. His love for you is not on trial. His salvation is not like, some people are like, well, I think I'm not saved because I got tempted to do this. Well, if you think that you're not saved because you get tempted to do something wrong, then just like all of us would be toast if that was true. The truth is that our salvation is secure when we've trusted in Jesus Christ and had faith in him alone. Faith in his finished work alone. Right? And it's in that place of trust that we experience this new life. And in that new life, we're going to experience all sorts of external trials and pressures, but God's trying to mold us through them. He's not trying to send a message like, see, you keep going through this. Something's wrong with you. You're flawed. You're screwed up. No. He lets you go through things so that you can mature and be complete. It's very interesting to me. It says here that through this, Jesus becomes our high priest and he becomes the author of our salvation. Have you let Jesus author your story? Have you let him redefine your story? We always have an angle on our life, but then we meet Jesus. And he says, yeah, you've seen this and you've seen that and you've seen this about yourself. But guess what? When you come to me, I become your author of your salvation. And he writes over our past with his blood. And he gives us redemption. And he gives us a new way to look at life. And he gives us a new way to tell our story. He gives us a new way to see the pain and the things that we've been through. And he gives us purpose and meaning. He removes shame. He brings hope into our lives. This is who Jesus is. Earlier in Hebrews, we learned that Jesus is not only the author of our salvation, he's the captain of our salvation. So could it be that this life of obedience is not about trying harder to obey on our own, but it's learning to follow the captain who's perfect in obedience. And because he perfectly obeyed in our place, we get to follow him. And our obedience is not a byproduct of us trying harder. It's a byproduct of us following the right captain, of us following the right author, of us surrendering to the right source, Jesus Christ himself, our high priest. I want to tell you a story about David Wilkerson. He's a country preacher in I think it was Pennsylvania, small church. And this is decades ago. He had a great impact on my dad's life through this book, The Crossing the Switchblade. It's the book my dad read when he surrendered his life to Jesus. He read it cover to cover as a drug addict and said, God, if you can do what you did for the man in this book, do it for me. So David Wilkerson, he's this country preacher, and God starts to speak to him and give him a vision about going to New York City to reach gang members. And it's kind of a radical vision for this country boy preacher. And he starts telling some people about the vision that God gave him, and God provided money, and there was a story in the newspapers that really compelled him because some young teenagers were in a gang, and they shot and they murdered a man, and they were going to trial, and he thought, God, I need to reach these kids that are going on trial, and he was praying for them and weeping for them and interceding for them. God, do something to intervene in these kids' lives. And so all these people in his church are praying for him, supporting him, like, oh, our pastor has this great vision. He's just totally pumped and said, go to New York City. And so he goes to New York City. He goes to where the trial's being held in the one of the first nights of the trial, and he goes into the courtroom, and there's all these news reporters there, and there's cameras there, and journalists, and all these people and families, and somehow he sneaks in the courtroom, and this high-profile murder case, and the proceedings go on for the night, and as the proceedings wind down and everybody's dismissed at the end of the night, he thinks, now's my chance. Maybe I can go approach the judge's bench and say, Your Honor, you know, I'm a pastor. I just would like to have a chance to try to figure out how I could meet with these boys' families or these boys and try to bring some redemption and try to help these boys that are struggling as a pastor, you know. And as he approaches the bench in this high-profile case, the bailiff and the security, the police officers that are there, they grab Pastor David Wilkerson, and they put cuffs on him, and they drag him out of the courtroom, and the judge is, you know, like saying, you know, order in the court, like, you know, get down, don't approach the bench, and it's a big scene, and as he's getting taken out of the courtroom, the cameras are there, and they're like, click, 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 who's this preacher that's getting arrested by the police at the end of this court case that tried to storm the bench? And so he goes home, and everybody sees the headlines about this preacher in the court case, and he's humiliated. If I remember the story correctly, it's been a little while since I've read the story, His parents, even it was one of the first times in his life that he remembers his own parents being embarrassed. His wife's humiliated. His church is full of shame and embarrassment that, like, why did our pastor do this? Wasn't it just good enough to pastor us here in the country? And why do you have to go try to do this big thing? And he's just totally humiliated. In the midst of his shame and embarrassment, God speaks to him and says, go back to New York City. I called you to reach the gangs of New York City. You need to reach out to those boys. He's like, God, no one's going to believe it's you. Look what happened last time. I'm not going to go. He's arguing with God, and God ends up providing a way. I think he snuck back in, secondly, a little more quietly without telling as many people that he's going back. He goes to the city and starts going through the neighborhoods and just praying, like, God, how am I going to find the family members of these boys that are in prison now? And so he meets some people, and he starts talking to them, and they end up bringing him to a rundown apartment complex in a rough neighborhood. And they walk up to a room and say, this is the family of some of the boys. And the family and some of the teenagers from the street, they start looking at Pastor David Wilkerson. And they start going, wait, are you that Davey guy? Are you that preacher that got grabbed by the cops in the courtroom? Dude, this is the preacher that the cops don't like. He's one of us, man. This is our guy. And the very thing that he thought disqualified him was actually the thing that gave him street cred. Come on, with the gang members and their families. And God used it to open a door. So check this out. The only way, God knew that the only way that the gangs of New York were going to receive David Wilkerson is when they realized that he became just like they were. And they weren't going to be able to come like him and experience this new life until they could see that he first became like them. This is what it's like in God, is that God knew that we weren't going to believe that we could become like him in this great salvation unless we first saw that Jesus became our high priest and he fully became like us first. This is where the gospel begins, is that Jesus took on flesh to become our high priest, to perfectly and always become like we are. And Jesus submitted to this process of suffering so that he could be qualified to be a great high priest. And in this process, it's just amazing because he learned things, and there's a picture for us. And the writer of Hebrews goes on to start to say that there's a process that some people in the Christian life have not been through yet. And there's a problem that's come. And so we talk about this great salvation in church and this great gospel, and I'm convinced that the gospel's more powerful than we really know, and that there's a depth and a scope to it that just burns brighter, it goes deeper the more that we learn about who God is. But if this salvation that God has promised is so great, that there's this power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes this gospel, if Jesus can save us to the uttermost, if Jesus is so sufficient as high priest, then why do so many Christians struggle to mature in their Christian life? Why do so many Christians spend time on a revolving door with the same bad habits, with the same addictive behavior, with the same nagging things, with the guilt, with a shameful heart, not feeling that they can have confidence to approach God and have a close relationship with him? Why do so many Christians struggle with the process of maturity? Why does it say to the listeners here of this text in Hebrews that they should have been teachers, but they're not teachers? In fact, they need somebody else to still teach them. Why does it say that these Christians are still drinking milk when they should have matured and gone on to meat and solid food? Well, I'm going to tell you, because the writer of Hebrews tells us. Why do Christians struggle to grow? It's right here in the text. First of all, if you're on milk and you're still a babe, it says because you are unskilled in the word of righteousness. The reason we lack maturity, we don't go from milk to meat. Now, Grace and I, we've got 4 beautiful children in 12 years of marriage. Yeah, we were not very good. We thought, we'll do the natural family planning. Forget that pill. We're just going to figure out, you know, God gave us these indicators in a woman's body. I read the Wikipedia version of family planning, and that probably should have read the whole book. And so obviously we weren't very good at it, and so we just had kids, which is awesome, which is way better than planning our family. It's just like, because it's been a thrill to have these beautiful kids. And 5 months into marriage, Grace got pregnant, and she comes in this room, and she's in our first apartment, our little one-bedroom apartment in Linwood, and she sits down on the couch, and she's like, I need to talk to you. And I'm like, okay, yeah, what's going on? She's like, I'm pregnant and you're going to be a dad. And she's like we had talked about, you know, a couple of years or so. And I was just like, I'm going to be a dad. And she's like, oh, and she's getting tears. She's like, you're happy. And I'm like, yeah, I'm happy. I'm going to be a dad. Like, are you sure? Like, how do you know this? Like, I don't know. I'm just a newly married dude. I know nothing about like this stuff. Right. Like, I mean, I know how it happens, but I don't know what happens after it happens, you know, like, hello. So I'm there and I'm like, what's going on? Like, I'm going to be a dad. And remember, we had this beautiful little Haley, our firstborn, and just this process of her growing, and she didn't like to sleep, and she liked to look around and see everybody, and she still doesn't like to sleep, and she still likes to be in all the action 10 years later, and she's almost 11, and she's just a beautiful girl, amazing. And I remember, though, that fun time when she first started to move to solid food, you know. And then at first it was fun. In fact, we would drive by like Jamba Juice or Starbucks, because once she got to be like a toddler, before she could like really have very many words yet, except, you know, probably like mama and dada, she's like 1 year old. And we drive by certain places, which probably should, we went there too much, right? And she'd go, because she knew, like, hey, that's the place with the goods. That's the place with the solid food. I want the Jamba Juice. I want the smoothie, you know. I want the tropical smoothie. And I don't know how to say that other than, And she, for real, she would do that in the back of our little car. And she'd sit there and we'd just crack up. And so, but she loved, and it was so fun to watch her start to eat solid food. And my wife always laughs at me because when I would feed our kids, you know, that solid food and have them open their mouth, every time I put food up to their mouth, I'd open my mouth too. It was like a reflex. It's like, as soon as I'm like going, I'm like, and even though my wife's laughing and points it out over and over, like, I can't help it. It's like, you know what I mean? Like, solid food is coming, right? So we're to desire maturity. We're to desire solid food. We're to desire to move from milk to meat, to come to a place of maturity. Just like once a kid starts to get a little taste of solid food, you can't have them anywhere near. Some of you that are about to have kids one day that are married and everything like that, right? Or maybe if you're here and you're great with child, like, if you don't have kids, you know, like, once they start getting a taste of solid food and they're just kind of somewhat near, they're just like grabbing at the table. They pull on the tablecloth. They do whatever it takes to like get that food, because they have tasted and they've seen that that is good. All of our American foods, you know, with MSG additives and extra sugar in it, right? They're like, hey, I had a little bit of that. Give me some more of that, right? And so they want solid food, and we're to desire, we're to crave that solid food in our lives. And there's another instance where 1 Peter talks about how the word of God is pure like milk, and we're to crave that pure milk. That's a different illustration. That's just talking about we should desire the word of God. Right, but in this illustration, it's using milk as a negative, saying that was a beginning phase that you should have grown out of. I almost told a joke about the La Leche League or whatever it is, and the, you know, the women that are, you know, still feeding, still nursing their like 7-year-old kids. And if you do that, Jesus loves you and so do I. But I'm always like, wow. When that kid can be like, hey, mom, I need a drink. And she covers him with like her sweater that goes down to her ankles, you know, like, woo. You're like, that's a little strange for my taste. But hey, more power. I'm sure there's more nourishment in those kids than in those of us feeding them cow milk, you know. But anyway. Is somebody leaving? Sorry about that. No, just kidding. Apparently, they kept that up. God bless you. Right, but we're to desire to go to solid food. God's desire for us is to be mature. And if we're unskilled in the word of righteousness, then we're stuck to milk. And secondly, the reason that we're not maturing, we're going through these cycles, is that we have not had the solid food, so that we don't know how to by reason of use of our senses, we don't know how to exercise in discernment between good and evil. And so it starts with being unskilled in the word of righteousness, and then the problem that starts manifesting in our lives is that we don't have discernment between good and evil, and therefore we're stuck in these cycles. Opportunities or relationships, opportunities to behave, we don't have this inner discernment because we're not skilled in the word of righteousness. And so we think, oh, this is probably going to be all right. And then we go, and it looks right to a man, the proverb says. There's a way that looks right to a man, but its end is death, right? So when we start growing in discernment, we start knowing, wait, that might even look good, but actually it's evil, and it's going to pull me away from the grace of God and from living in the freedom of my salvation, right? And sometimes it looks good, sometimes it looks evil, sometimes it's confusing, but when we start maturing, we start having a sense of what's right and wrong. So the process of maturity comes, number one, from becoming skilled in the word of righteousness. If the lack of maturity was a result of being unskilled in the word of righteousness, then maturity comes from being skilled in the word of righteousness. Now, a lot of Christians think that the word of righteousness, the gospel of righteousness, I would call it, because Romans 1, 16 and 17 says, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation to him who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. For it is written, the just shall live by faith. But in that scripture, in Romans 1, 17, for in the gospel the righteousness of God is revealed. I'm telling you guys, Hebrews 5 says right here, the reason you're still on milk is because you're unskilled in the word of righteousness. He's saying you need a revelation of righteousness. Paul in Romans 1 says, guess what? The gospel reveals righteousness. So the gospel of righteousness starts to reveal truth and reality into your life of what righteousness means, how to have right standing before God, because the greatest need of mankind is right standing before God. Jesus said, if you want everything to be added to your life, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. So the gospel of righteousness, the revelation of righteousness, is not just to say that Jesus died in your place, say a prayer, and you won't go to hell when you die, you'll go to heaven. That's part of it. It's a very good part of it. It's wonderful. But the gospel of righteousness has the depth and a scope to transform the way you see life, to understand the completeness of Jesus's righteousness on your behalf, so that you start to live in confidence before God, you move from milk to meat, and you start a process of maturity and obedience in your life. So Jesus, when he's getting baptized in water, he shows up to John the Baptist in the river. And John the Baptist knew who Jesus was. John the Baptist had been prophesying, there's one coming who's going to take away the sins of the world. And here's Jesus standing right in front of him. And Jesus says, John, you need to baptize me in water. You need to immerse me in this water. And John says, I'm not even worthy to loose a strap on your sandal. You need to baptize me, Jesus. And Jesus says, you need to do this so that all righteousness will be fulfilled. And you'll start to see through Hebrews, through and many writings in the New Testament, that there are specific mentions of how Jesus is fulfilling all righteousness. Jesus said in Matthew's gospel, I did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it or to establish it. Right? Because Jesus is the fulfillment of all the law and prophets. Jesus is the one who came to fulfill all righteousness. Mankind's great problem before God is that sin was an eternal crime against an eternal God, and we needed a righteous substitute that could completely fulfill the law so that the problem of sin over all mankind, over all time, could be solved once and for all. And this is what the Bible's talking about, the word of righteousness, is that Jesus came in right standing with God, and he went through much suffering, but he learned obedience, and through it he became the author of our salvation, completely fulfilling all the righteous requirements of the law so that he never had unbroken right standing before God. And then he bestows on us through the revelation of righteousness that by faith we stand in the same place as Jesus does before God when we enter through him. So your ability to live in salvation and freedom and hope, to live in confidence before God, is not about what you've done. It's about having faith in the revelation, the word of righteousness. And you need to start to study the word of God, not just for general principles, but you need to start to become a student of righteousness. And when you start to become a student of the gospel of righteousness, things start to line up, and you start to have confidence, not based on what you've done, but based on who he is. And then your obedience is motivated because you realize that your obedience grows in the soil of his obedience. Your righteousness comes as a byproduct of what he imparts to you by faith. Jesus is so amazing, so amazing. And that, secondly, if you're going to process maturity, you not only become skilled in the word of righteousness, which is what Christ has done for us to bring us into right standing with God, is that he's perfectly complete, you guys, in what he's done for us. He perfectly represented us before the Father. And there's no lack of it. And when you start to understand the requirements to fulfill all righteousness, if you start to understand what the Bible would call every jot and every tittle of the law and the prophets and every single little nook and cranny and every T that needed to be crossed and every I that needed to be dotted, you would realize the absurdity of your own ability to be right with God. But when you realize that Jesus becomes that perfect fulfillment, and that he identifies you with you in your weakness, that he doesn't fulfill it and then shame us for like, come on, guys, why couldn't you do it? But when he fulfills it, he comes to us in compassion, and he knows what it's like to be pulled on in temptation and in human weakness. and he has compassion on us to aid us, saying, I've perfectly fulfilled this for you. So your ability to come to me and have confidence is not based on your own righteous deeds. It's now based on your faith in what I've done. And if you would start to believe God tonight in what he's done for you in righteousness, your whole world will begin to change. Number two, you have your senses trained, discerning between good and evil. That's the other process of maturity then. Is if you're getting skilled in the word of righteousness, understanding the difference between right and wrong is not enough. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil brought a curse, right? So it's not just about, well, I know that's right and I know that's wrong. It's not about human efforts. It's about becoming skilled in the word of righteousness. And that righteousness starts to affect your conscience, starts to affect your senses, starts to affect the way that you process things, even emotionally, spiritually, the things that go on in your life. And through your senses, you start to be able to discern, I know this is good, I know this is evil, not because I just have a knowledge of it, but because this word is so rich in me of righteousness that I have an inner sense of the Holy Spirit leading me, guiding me, convicting me, empowering me to do what's good and to abstain from what's evil. Right, and there starts to become fruit, good fruit in my life because I'm being skilled in the word of righteousness. I'm not just trying to do good things and avoid evil things because that's a cycle of performance. I'm just trying to cover our shame with our own ability, and that always falls flat on its face. But those that get their senses trained by becoming skilled in the word of righteousness, there's a maturity that starts to come to us. And the third thing we do to grow in maturity then is what results is you have this discernment that comes as a byproduct. The word of righteousness is that you start to manifest a life of obedience. And it goes back to that little phrase, not please and thank you, but the little phrase my dad used to always tell me, I know you know, son, but do you do? I know you know, but do you do? Dad, I know. Clean your room. I know you do. I know you know, son, but do you do? And I was like, you know, those words, they still come after me. And I don't know if I use them on my kids very much or not, but I do, huh? My wife says, yes, you do. Okay, so we're passing on that generational blessing. Glory to God. Right? And so the student has become the teacher. And I'm passing on this lesson to my children that God's trying to get us to see is that our obedience does not bring us into favor with God. Our obedience does not make us righteous, right? It's Jesus' obedience for us that makes us righteous. But then if we're going to manifest what Jesus says is ours and we're going to walk into a place of maturity, then we're going to get skilled in righteousness, start to have the right discernment, being led by the Spirit of God, and then we're going to start seeing the fruit of obedience in our lives. And I'll tell you what, when you realize that your love, God's love for you is not always on trial based on what you're going through, it becomes a lot easier to start to obey God. Because you start blaming God, and the devil would like nothing more for us to start blaming God in the midst of trouble, saying, he must not be there for me. He must not love me. He loves me not. And every day is not a trial in whether God loves me or not. Every day is an opportunity for me to manifest righteousness, for me to manifest the discernment that God is giving me between good and evil, knowing that I have a high priest, that even if I have a day where I feel like going astray, Jesus is there for me right in the middle of it as a compassionate high priest, and saying, I obeyed for you. Now you can obey. Because I'm here for you. I got you. Lean on me. Trust in my ability. Trust in my righteousness for you. So the Christian life is first having God uncover for us what Christ has done, and then obeying from the place of radical righteousness and acceptance. So I don't obey to earn acceptance in God. I obey because I've been accepted. I don't obey to become his child. Of course, I obey believing in him, but that's simply the first thing the Bible says is that his commandments are not burdensome. And what is his commandment? It's that first we believe that Jesus is the Son of God. So all obedience starts with believing in Jesus' obedience on your behalf. That he's the Son of God, that he's the high priest who's sufficient for you. And then your obedience starts to manifest as a byproduct of trusting and believing in him. There's a few of you that are excited tonight with me. Hallelujah. So I want you to meditate on the word of righteousness. I want you to meditate on the gospel of righteousness, to study it, to pray it. I'll tell you, this is the fountain of hope that I live with every single day, is when I realize that who Jesus is and what he's done on my behalf is what brings me sufficient confidence before God. I used to live in a cycle of shame, condemnation, and guilt over and over and over again. And all of my efforts were vain in trying to scrub this feeling of filth off of my soul. But when I surrendered to the love of God, said, God, I can't do it anymore. I can't. I've realized I've tried to add to your blood. I've tried to add to the perfection of your work. And there's nothing I can add to a perfect work. There's nothing I can add to a perfect high priest. But all I can start to do now is trust that what you did is enough. And I quit letting my past have the final word. Even though the past might feel real and those emotions might feel real of where you've used to be, right? Is that when you let Jesus become the high priest, he becomes the author of your story. He blots out your past and he writes a new perspective. And as the young man that came forward today, one of them to give his life to Jesus, he said, I was so hopeless. I just felt like I don't even know if I wanted to live anymore. And I always thought I had to work for love. And now I know that God loves me. One of our men, Bob, pouring truth into his life. And Bob said, your life's been focused on present to the past and always looking over your shoulder. If you could ever be accepted, look at all the bad things you've done. Look at all the evil that you've done in your life. And he said, but Jesus now, he rewrites your story and now you can live present future. He said, God's blotted out your past and he's given you a pure heart. He's given you a new heart. Now you can live present future because you surrender to Jesus as your high priest. He becomes the captain and the author of our salvation. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward with communion elements. Pass them out. As soon as you guys get up here is fine, just to pass them through the room. And if you've not yet believed in Jesus right now, I just want to give you the opportunity. We're going to stay seated for just a moment. We'll stand and we'll have time of prayer. But communion is a time where we celebrate that Jesus' body was broken for us through his suffering and his blood was spilled for us on the cross. And he became our perfect sacrifice. He became not only our high priest, but he became the sacrifice for our sin because he was perfect and sinless. And if you're here and you have not trusted in Jesus yet, but as I've been preaching about who Jesus is, you say, I want him in my life. I want forgiveness of my sin. I want the gift of eternal life. You can believe in Jesus right now. Invite him into your life. Surrender your life to him and you can take communion with us. And I want to know if that's you today. If you say, I'm here, if you just raise your hand and say, that's me. I want Jesus. I want forgiveness of my sin. You want to join other people that throughout our day today have said, I need Jesus in my life. Is there anybody here and you say, I want Jesus. I want my sins forgiven. I want him to become my high priest. Would you just raise your hand right where you're at so we can pray with you tonight, give you a Bible? There's a hand in the back. Come on. Is there anybody else that will join one and say, I need it. I need him. I'm tired. Are you tired? Do you need rest for your soul? Trust in Jesus. Is there anybody else? And you say, that's me. I'm tired of running. Maybe you've believed in him before and you know that you've been running and it's time for you to come back home. Is there anybody that say, I want to come back tonight? I want to trust in that place again. Come on, brother. Come on, sister. Is there anybody else tonight that would say that? You can stay in your seat just for now. We'll bring you up in just a minute. But I appreciate your boldness. Come on. I love it. I want to give you a hug. Is there anybody else? You say, I'm tired of running because he loves you. You think that he's been judging you and blasting you and you've gone astray, but tonight you see that he goes, there's another. Come on. Let's just pray this prayer for those that are believing for the first time or those that are coming back home. Let's pray this prayer together as the elements are being passed. Say this with me. Repeat this with me if you mean it from your heart. Say, Father God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus to be the sacrifice for my sins and to be my high priest. Jesus, I give my life to you. I turn from my life of sin and leading my own way. And I surrender to you and to the free gift of righteousness that you give to me. Give me a new heart and give me power to obey and to walk after you in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on. I know it's hard to clap with the communion elements in your hand. Clap. Oh, no, I just spilled. We don't want to do that. But Jesus, come on, he's after your heart. His presence is here tonight because he's drawing some of you. You've been under shame. You've been under guilt. And it's time to let that voice be silenced. See him becoming this body broken for us, him spilling his blood for us. It shows he did enough. Quit trying to add to what he would do and just start accepting who he is. Repent, turn from your own efforts, from your own sin, from your own ability, from just running astray and doing your own thing, and surrender to this one who loves you more than you can imagine, that he became just like us so that he could die and offer us as an acceptable people to God. And now we get to come boldly because of his perfection on our behalf. This is good news, you guys. Every day we can live with confidence before God. Every day in the midst of trial and temptation, in the midst of suffering and need, we can come boldly to his throne of grace because he loves us and he's moved with compassion towards us. We have a good God. We have a good Savior. We have a great high priest. Father God, we come boldly today, this night, being aware that we're limited in our flesh. We can only do so much, and it's not enough to measure up. But you completely measured up for us so that we could have confidence in who you are. Father, I thank you for showing us tonight how you see us, that you see us in the midst of struggle as worthy of love and compassion, not a God who will judge us and cast us off. The judgment that comes is only for those that reject you, Jesus. But tonight, Lord, we're hearing that there's hearts that are, that faith is leaping in them tonight, saying, I get to come and I'm going to run to him and I'm going to quit straying. And we just declare as we take communion that Jesus, you are our source. You're our righteousness. All of our hope and righteousness is only in your blood, is all in what you've done for us. And so we thank you that you became like us so that we could become like you. You left the comforts of heaven so that we could experience the comfort of a relationship and a secure home in you. And so we thank you, God, for what you're doing in our hearts and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's receive the bread together. Thank you for your body broken, and we thank you for your blood that was shed. Let's receive the cup. Let's stand to our feet tonight, and let's just thank Jesus for being a sufficient sacrifice and high priest. Come on, thank you, Jesus, for who you are, for what you've done.